Hello everybody, this is a presentation prepared on a case study done in one of the Ethiopian highlands some years ago and selected by the Eastern African team enrolled in the course to study the stakeholder engagement in land gradation projects. The project was conducted to analyze stakeholder engagement in massive soil and water conservation project conducted by the Ethiopian government some years ago and according to the research which is found unsuccessful in meeting the purpose. My name is Daniel Gabayou, I'm from Ethiopia and team leader for the group. The presentation consists of four major areas of the case study relevant to the course. These are the profile of the ecosystem, such as the size, topography and types of land use, types of ecosystem services the watershed provides, and the extent of land degradation and the cause of land degradation. And finally, I will introduce the stakeholders involved in the project. The name of the watershed in the case study is called Jamoga Basin and is located in one of the northern Ethiopian regional states, Amhara, which is also a source to the Blue Nile River. The Jamoga watershed is the source, therefore part of the Blue Nile Basin with a total area of 364 square kilometers. About 24,000 people live within the watershed with a density of approximately 66 people per square kilometer. The watershed is characterized by high altitude topographic features ranging from 2,450 to 3,800 meters above sea level. That shows that even the lowest altitude found in the watershed is found at the higher elevation. When we see the composition of landscapes in the basin, predominantly common landscapes are hilly slopes, wetland and plateau areas. The hilly slopes are responsible for runoff. This part of the area. These areas were once covered by forest are now exposed to the direct impact of rain, and coupled with the slope they have, they are becoming the major source of runoff. The wetland is mainly the plain area the streams are flowing through, and we find also plateau area with moderate slope, which is responsible for water infiltration and groundwater recharging. Okay, what are the major land use types identified in the case study? According to the researcher who did the case study, there are a total of 8 land use types or land cover types identified in the watershed presented here in the table with their total area coverage. From the figures presented in the table, the largest part, which is approximately 66% of the total, is farmland with settlements, followed by the marsh area or the marshy land close to covering close to 15%. A land that is totally degraded or which is currently used as a grazing land covers about 3.5% of the total watershed. Also, we will find some remains of forest land and woodland which are around 10% of the watershed combined. In the map, you will see the green and the light green areas located scattered throughout the watershed. If we closely observe the major livelihoods people are dependent on in this total watershed, it will not be too difficult to imagine the extent of pressure people would have on the land and on its sources. Both pastoral and agropastoral activities demand suitable land for crop and grass production, but the truth is the opposite. In most parts of East African highlands, you will find people expanding to more forest land and woodland because of lack of suitable land for crop production. This expansion to other land use types or land units is a major cause for resource degradation. As you can see, there is also a small percentage, which is less than 1% of the people who are engaged in activity which is different from crop and animal production. It's called agro-silvicultural, which is mainly engaged in silk production for that is used for input of industries that produce silk. Knowing major income sources that people are dependent on is also very important to examine how people living in the watershed are contributing to the overutilization of resources in the watershed. Majority of the farmers are dependent on land for consumption and income. As such, they produce crops. Basically, they produce crop. They also rear animals like ox, cow, sheep, and poultry. They use it for home consumption as well as selling to the local markets. That shows outflow of their agricultural products beyond the basin to other areas too. On top of crop production and animal production, farmers in Temoga watershed also supplement their income by producing charcoal. And they produce charcoal not from their own plantation, but from communal land, which is also causing major land degradation in the basin. Up until now, we have seen major description of Temoga Basin that will help us to picture how the ecosystem and the people living in the ecosystem look like. Now we are going to go through the ecosystem services available in the basin, classified under four major terms of ecosystem service, such as provisioning, regulating, supporting, and cultural services. Under the provisioning categories, several services that our dwellers are dependent on are identified from the information already described in the previous slides. Hence, for a livelihood and income which is entirely dependent on the land and its resources, the provision comes from the ecosystem in the form of crop and animal products, water and fuel load. Basically, this service is responsible to sustain life in the basin. The second service types identified for Temoga ecosystem is regulating role. It plays in the overall microclimate composition and control. The landscape is responsible to create constant water source in the form of surface and subsurface flow. The vegetation and soils will help to regulate carbon dioxide level in the atmosphere and in the soil too. And finally, the ecosystem plays a role by continuously supporting nutrient cycling, decomposition, and new soil formation. Last but not least is the cultural role the ecosystem plays. By having a beautiful scene in the alpine zone, is which is attractive for ecotourism. The alpine is located at the highest elevation area, which is not suitable for agriculture. When we are very close to the major focus area of the course, and the following slides will take us through the degradation, major causes and impacts seen in the watershed. It is known that land degradation is a gradual process and is a result of long-term human activities on the land for their various demands. Major causes of land degradation in the Chomoka Basin are deforestation, type of cultivation practices, and overuse of the land without a break. The impacts of land degradation are seen in disturbing water balance, washing away of fertile soil, and overall microclimatic disorder. As I mentioned in the first slide, the case study was conducted to evaluate stakeholder engagement in soil and water conservation project implemented to rehabilitate degraded environments. The government of Ethiopia implemented massive soil and water conservation campaigns to plant trees on communally held hillsides, to establish soil and water conservation structures on cultivated fields, and also promote private tree planting by individual farmers. According to the researcher, he evaluated the role of various stakeholders in the big project of this soil and water conservation projects with the assumption of their involvement in the project, and the conclusion he reached that lesser involvement of stakeholders, specifically farmers, was a major cause for the project's failure. But as you can see from the case study, various activities such as afforestation, tree planting, agroforestry, and soil and water conservation structures have been implemented to combat land degradation as well as rehabilitate the degraded environment. So who are those stakeholders the specific project didn't involve as indicated in the case study? We call stakeholders in this study those group of people who are affected by the basin. These include farmers living within the watershed, those people in the downstream village, such as those living along the river Chomoka and below the watershed. Stakeholders also include users of river Blue Nile, living far, far away from the watershed. They are affected by the Chomoka basin because the Chomoka River is a tributary of Blue Nile. So the people will be affected by the activities of people living at the source of the river. Chomoka administration office is also one of the major stakeholders of the basin as a whole and the leading agent in the soil and water conservation project. Thank you very much for your attention this far, and in order to keep the presentation within the scope of week 1 and week 2 topics, I have to stop right here. But before I go, let me show you some pictures I got from a different study conducted at the watershed in 2012. The two pictures at the top are pictures taken to show the temperate and alpine zone topographies within the Chomoka Basin, and the bottom two pictures showing the features of soil erosion and land degradation that is forming new gullies in the area. Thank you very much again, and enjoy the course.